Yeah, I was speaking to someone just before the service, and she was telling me that she had the opportunity to be up here and share a testimony, and she didn't realize how much of a battle it was, you know, the spiritual battle that was going on before, during, and after. And I couldn't agree more. I couldn't agree more. I know that, you know, many of you who have had the privilege of sharing on this stage would share that same feeling that it can be a real battle. You know, and you know, leading up to this Sunday, the last few weeks, I can tell you it's been a real wrestle, a real wrestle. And so I just want to pray for us right now and just ask the Holy Spirit to just do his thing. Amen. Dear God, we just thank you for today. We ask that even as we are here, we ask that you move. Your Holy Spirit just moves. You reach in, you touch, you change lives. You do your thing. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. A few years ago, my dad shared with me an idea about setting up a wellness center. A wellness center. So this was a place where someone would come and have his or her holistic health looked at. It was a place where your whole person would be looked after. So it wasn't a illness-based model. It was a wellness-based model. So a recovery model. It wasn't like a, you know, you come in when you are sick, when you're ill. It's a wellness-based model. So it's looking after our health before things happen rather than only when things happen. Yep. And it's not reactionary. So it's quite a proactive-based care. You know, as we approach Christmas, this season is really a really busy time of the year. I've had numerous conversations with many people, and you know, when I ask them, how's it going? The standard response is busy. You know, really, really busy. You know, this is a season where quite often health takes a back seat. We often eat too much. Exercise goes out the window because our schedules are all over the place. You know, we don't sleep enough, we don't rest. You know, health goes out the window. I'm hoping that we can take a pause today from the busyness of Christmas. And can I invite you to step into the wellness center today, the wellness center here today. We're going to have a little bit of a health checkup. Is that okay? We'll have a health checkup. Everyone's going to have a health checkup today. Next slide. This verse, I'll just read it to you. 3 John 1 verse 2. Dear friend, I pray that you may enjoy good health and that all may go well with you, even as your soul is getting along well. What an amazing verse. See, John understood when he was writing to his friend Gaius, John understood that true health was body, soul, and spirit. You couldn't actually separate the compartments. It's all together. When your physical body is hurt, it affects your emotion. It affects your spirit as well. When things are not right in the spirit, it can manifest in your body as well. So it can't be separated. We can't just look at one aspect and neglect the others. We have to look at them as a whole. So health and wellness involves your whole person. Two important aspects. Remember, we're in this wellness center here. Two important aspects when considering your health is diet and exercise. Yep. Any good doctor will tell you that. Right, Hawks? Any good doctor will tell you diet is important and exercise is important. All right. So I'll give you a little insight into the Go Family pantry, okay? So I raided my pantry this morning, even when Carol was asleep. And I managed to find a few things, right? So there's Smith chips, really some of the best chips in the world. Arnott's Tim Tams, you know, that's good. Very, very Australian so far. Oh yes. Can we ever go past spam? I don't know. There's nothing better than spam. You know, we had a party once, and Waikin was there, and we had to fry spam, right? He was cutting it so thin because it was so precious. You know, he had to get like, you know, 50 slices out of this tin. So he was just cutting it, you know, so because spam is amazing, right? And then, of course, after COVID, spam got really expensive as well. And then we have good old Coke. Love that. Love that. Okay. On the other side, got a bit of spinach. Got some blueberries. Got a carrot. Somehow people are not quite excited about this table. Lamb chops and maybe some camembert cheese. My daughter loves camembert. All right. So if we're looking at these two tables, right, if I could ask you, if I asked you which table, if you were going to have, I was going to ask you to make a healthy choice on what to eat, which table would you choose? That one? This would be my choice, but yeah, I think most of us would agree this would be the healthy choice. This would be the junk food table, right? Don't even know what is in spam, actually. But anyways, okay. So this side of this table actually has very low nutritional value. But it can be so tempting. It's so easy to get, relatively affordable, and it lasts for ages and ages because it's full of preservatives, right? The other side, a little bit more expensive, a little bit harder to get, harder to keep, you know, but obviously the healthy choice. What we choose to feed our bodies actually affects our health, our function, and our well-being. If we feed it rubbish, I'm not saying this is rubbish, but if we feed it junk, you actually feel like rubbish. You know, you feel not that great about yourself. But if you feed it well, if you feed it good, balanced nutrition, you tend to feel much better about yourself. This actually comes out a lot in endurance sports. So I've been cycling a little bit in the last few years. I find that if I've fed on this the night before, about 15 Ks into the ride, I feel like this. Yeah. But if I've eaten this the night before or some other good nutrition, you kind of feel a lot better about yourself during the ride. So, you know, what we choose to feed our bodies actually affects our health and well-being, how we feel about ourselves. How about our mind? How about our mind? Are we careful with what we feed our minds? Are we careful? Because it will affect our heart as well as our spiritual health. It will affect our heart as well as our spiritual health. What are we feeding our minds? Where do we get our feeding from? What we read, what we watch, who we talk to and what we talk about, whose opinions we think are important, and where we go to when we're searching for answers. You know, we had a couple of friends who used to be in this church. Actually, they used to be leaders in this church. We lost touch for a little while. We still lost touch. But you know, we're seeing them on social media nowadays, and we see their posts, the things that they post. They used to be, mind you, they used to be leaders in this church. Suddenly, you see what they're posting is actually very anti-God, very anti-God, anti-Christianity, questioning the very goodness of God and almost mocking Christians for their antiquated belief system. When you think about it, would that have happened overnight? I don't think so. You know, it would have been a gradual feeding. It would have been a gradual feeding. Conversations with people that they're hanging out with, maybe books and articles that they're reading, maybe videos that they're watching, maybe things that they stand for and things that they're consuming. All of this adds to our worldview, the way we see the world. I don't think these friends of ours are alone. I think all of us can be susceptible to this. You know, it's a gradual shift that can take place without us realizing. Just like the body, you know, you don't go from slim to overweight overnight, right? You don't wake up and go, whoa, what happened? No, that, it's a couple of extra visits to Macca's. It's a couple of, you know, late night kind of, you know, kebabs or whatever it is. You know, then you realize that, hey, you know, 5 years later, I'm kind of not quite what I used to look like, you know, 5 years ago. Same as the mind. It's a gradual shift. It's a gradual shift. It's things that you start feeding it. We start being a little bit desensitized by what we watch, what we read, what we choose to participate in, listen to. It shifts our thinking. Shifts our thinking. Our beliefs and values get shaped by what we feed our minds. And it starts to change. It changes our worldview. What we feed our minds will shape our worldview. While we don't want to be ignorant, we don't want to be ill-informed or misinformed about the world around us, but these things cannot be the only thing or the main thing that we're feeding our minds with. We need to understand that what we feed us, ourselves shapes us. What we feed our bodies shapes us. What we feed our minds also shapes us, also shapes our view, how we react. You know, at the beginning of this year, Carol and I decided to purchase a house. You know, and we put down an offer, got accepted, got the deposit accepted, and there was quite a long settlement period. In the middle of that settlement, so everything's been accepted. You know, the offer has been accepted and everything, but we haven't settled yet. In the middle of that, COVID hit. So every day from the time COVID hit, I don't know whether you guys remember when COVID first hit, how everything just started happening so quickly, isn't it? This got shut down, this restriction, that restriction, everything started happening really quick. And I started to panic about the house, going like, you know, I'm reading report after report that property prices are going to plummet 30%, in maybe good estimates, 30%, maybe 50%, you know. Oh, maybe it's not a good time to buy. You know, why did we do this? You know, what are we doing with all this? You know, I would wake up first thing in the morning. What I would do would be get on the phone, look at the news feed, what's happened overnight, you know, what's happening in America, what's happening in the UK, you know, what's happening over here. And that would be what I would be feeding my mind with. First thing every time in the morning. I couldn't sleep. I really struggled with that. I really, really struggled with the decision to purchase the house. Thank God there's, you know, my wife there to talk, pray with me. There were other people that I spoke to, good counsel as well. And I also made a decision to spend time talking to God and asking Him about this as well. Long story short, God was in control the whole time. We're in that house right now, praise God. But he spoke to me during that time. But we have to be very careful. What are we feeding our mind? What are we feeding our mind? Because it shapes us. I love this passage. If we can have the passage up. This was one of the passages that God led me to when I was deliberating over the house. The first part in particular, so Philippians 4, verse 4. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. You know, this passage really spoke to me during the time when I was deliberating over the house. But at that time, I didn't read on, but now I will read on. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received and heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. What are we feeding our minds? What we are feeding our minds will affect how we think and react in situations. Just like the choices we make with food and drink and how it affects our body and how we react during that time. Can I have the table up, please? Right. Brain food table. I wonder how many of us are brave enough to actually fill this out and actually show it to our friends. So the source of brain food, can come from many different places. You know, television and movies, music, social media, internet and news, books, Bible, conversations with people. And I wonder how many of us will be able to write down the amount of time we actually spend in each of these things. But we want to only use your free time. Take out your sleeping time, take out your work time, take out your time at school and what you actually have to do, and put that down, amount of time that you actually spend in each of those things. Going to the next column, what percentage of that actually qualifies for the Philippians 4 verse 8 principle? Are the things that we're feeding, are they true? Are they noble? Are they right? Are they pure? Are they lovely? Are they admirable? Are they excellent? And are they praiseworthy? And then you look at the last part of the table. How much of this source, this particular source, shapes your thinking, shapes your worldview? Could it be just that you spend a lot of time looking at your news, the news and the media, and you keep referring to it as gospel? Keep feeding yourself CNN, Fox News, Nine News, and you check it religiously. I certainly was when I was deliberating over the house. Maybe it's gossip when you catch up with friends. Maybe we're spending way too much time on social media. I was having a conversation with one of the youth today, a few days ago, and he said some fact. I can't remember what the fact was. He said it as fact. And I go, and Carol asked, what's your source? Oh, I saw it on Facebook. Okay. Yeah. So is that fact? Is that fact? We don't know. But what are you feeding? How much time are you spending? If you look down the list, if you do the table, are there things that are there that are negatively affecting your thinking, yours and my thinking? Does God want you to reduce or eliminate any of these things? And how can you manage your time to include more Philippians 4:8 type things? Things that are right, things that are noble, things that are pure, things that are lovely, things that are praiseworthy. How can you include more of those things into what you're feeding your mind? So a healthy diet consists of making the right choices in food and drink, making the right choices in what we feed our minds. You know, I believe on top of being well-informed, I think it involves spending time reading the Word of God, listening to good preaching and teaching, reading good godly books and articles. You could say it's food for the soul. Spending time in conversation with people that would give you godly perspectives. Have you noticed that if you spend time with cynical people, you end up becoming cynical as well? But if you spend time with people that have and give a God perspective, you too get shaped that way. How much time are we spending? What is our diet like, family? What's our diet like? Okay. So the first thing we looked at in this wellness center is your diet. What are we feeding our body and mind? The second thing we need to look at is exercise. So, ever since the start of this year, ever since the start of this year, I've been driving my son, Kai, to school. So he goes to school quite near where I work. So I have the opportunity of, you know, 3 or 4 times a week actually driving with him to school. So we have nice conversations along the way. We usually do our devotional while we're there in the car, as well as talk about a whole lot of things. So one of those conversations was after a night when Carol, my wife, was actually helped Kai with his math. He had a math test that day. And so she actually helped him with his math. So he started conversations by saying, "Mummy's really, really good in math." I said, "Yes, I agree. Mummy is very good in math." Then he stopped a while, and then he thought about it, and then he looked at me. "What are you good at?" Okay, if you know Kai, he is a very respectful guy. Okay, he didn't mean it that way. I could see it in his mind. He was clicking over. He thinks very highly about the people he loves and he's close with. So I could see it in his mind. He goes like, "Mummy's good at math. Gong Gong is good at science. You know, Gong Gong helps me with science. Grandma helps me and teaches me with English. And Kyla is very artistic and does dance and music, and she's good at that. That leaves you. What are you good at?" So I thought about it. Well, I was like, I'm actually not bad at English as well, Kai. And then he thought about it. He said, "But you can't spell." Fair point. And then I said, "I'm also not good at the rules of English, all the grammar rules. I don't know what an adjective, a verb is, all that kind of thing." And then we sat there in silence for a minute and then went like, "Well, then can't really say I'm good at English, really, is it?" So silence again for a little while. And then he turned around and he said, "I guess you're fitter than all of us." And then he moved on. He was going like, "Okay, we moved on from that conversation." So fitness. So apparently fitness is my thing. Fitness is my thing. When I thought about it, yep, you know, that's right. I do enjoy a good little lunge early in the morning just to get the heart rate going. Actually, speaking of lunges, 15 years ago, I was at a Bucks night. And there was Superman there in an afro lunging and doing squats. Some things just get burnt into your memory and you never forget those things. But anyways, we move on. Fitness. Fitness is my thing. So apparently fitness is my thing. My question to you today is, how fit are you? How fit are you? Do you invest time into your fitness? Unfortunately, when it comes to physical fitness, there are no shortcuts. You know, I sometimes wish I could kind of tape on some electrodes onto my stomach, and then I'll get a six-pack by just sitting there binging on ice cream and Netflix. You know, six-pack straight away. Or is there some app I could download, and then just by downloading the app, I've got abs. You know, no, it doesn't work that way. Not for physical fitness. You actually have to get on your bike. You have to run. You have to lift those weights. You have to wake up early. Go for that swim. Have that walk daily. You just have to spend the time. There is no shortcut. Look at what Paul said in Romans 12, verse 1 and 2. "Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, His good, pleasing, and perfect will." First things first, it is not ungodly to look after your body. Can we be clear about that? Taking care of your physical body, the fitness of your body, is an act of worship to God. That's what Romans says. That's what Paul says. Okay, it's not me. It's what Paul says. We are called to offer our bodies as a living sacrifice. This aspect of holistic care can sometimes be overlooked in our Christian walk. Amen? Taking time to exercise, taking time to eat well, taking time to sleep well, to do things that you enjoy, to relax, learning to relax, are all part and parcel of looking after your body. Sometimes we miss this by just focusing on the spiritual. Some of us, I don't know, you know, if it's you, "If I kill myself serving God and His church, God will be pleased with me." Or, "It's okay to wear my body down doing God's work." This type of thinking is actually counter what Paul is saying. You have to do both. You have to do both. Look after your body, serve God. Look after your body, serve God. It is not or, it is and. Both. There's a difference between putting God first and putting God in the center. I'll say that again. There's a difference between putting God first and putting God in the center. First means that whatever's first takes priority over everything else. So if the thing that I put first takes up all my time, all my energy, all my resource, then I neglect two down. Whatever's on two down the list, I neglect everything else. So if God, serving God takes up all my time, all my energy, all my resource, then I neglect my family, my friends, I don't worry about my health, I don't care about my relationships, I don't care about work. Does that work that way? I don't think so. Whereas placing God in the center means that God is in the center of all of those things, all of the aspects, every part of your life, God is in the center of that. Family, work, health, church, ministry, relationships, rest, hobbies, and enjoyment, all of those things, God is in the center. While we must look after our body and our mind's fitness, how about our spiritual fitness? This also needs work. The same way in which we train our bodies to get physically fit, we also need to work out our spiritual life. It does not take care of itself, just the same way as this body doesn't take care of itself. When Paul talks about renewal in the verse, he means the adjustment of the moral and spiritual vision and thinking to the mind of Christ. This is designed to have a transformative effect on our lives. As we study God's word, His truth reshapes the way we think, aligns it with God. As our thinking aligns with Him, His Spirit shapes our attitude, motivations, and eventually behaviors to match Christ. Can I suggest some practical ways for us to get spiritually fit today? One, read and memorize scripture, to have it hidden in our heart. I grew up in a Brethren church, and every week we go to Sunday school, we will be given a memory verse, and then we have to come back the next week and actually recite that memory verse. I even went to the Chinese church to memorize Chinese memory verses as well, which I have no idea about today anymore, but anyways, it was there. Memorizing scripture, to have it in our time of need. And God can bring that up. That is one way to get spiritually fit. Meditating on God's word is another. Not just so that you can know more, so that you can prove other people wrong, but actually to have the truth embedded in your heart. And hopefully that truth will make real change. Make real change. How about prayer? That's another way to get spiritually fit. Not just to ask God for things, but actually to spend time with Him and also hear from Him. How about having healthy discussions with others? Not just to prove you're right or to be heard, but actually to have a different perspective. There's other people with amazing godly perspectives that you can hear from and that can help with your fitness as well. How about listening and meditating on good, sound biblical teaching to inspire us? How about spending time in music worship just to praise our Heavenly Father in heaven? You know, during the beginning of the lockdown, our family, because we weren't able to meet here, our family had family worship in our house, in our living room. And that was an amazing time. It was a time where we could just share with one another and praise and worship God together. All these things take work. There's actually no shortcut. Just like physical fitness, there's no shortcut to spiritual fitness as well. How are we doing so far in the wellness center? Are we doing okay? How's the checkup? How's the health checkup? Are we going okay? So we talked about diet and how it's important to our body and our mind. We talked about exercise and how we need to keep our body and our spirit fit and healthy. How do we know that we are okay? How do we know that we are healthy on the inside? How do we know that we're fit and we're healthy on the inside? What is the evidence of this? I'll just show you a short clip.
So, Riley, how was the first day of school?
Fine, I guess.
Did you guys pick up on that?
Sure did.
Something's wrong.
Signal the husband.
Uh-oh, she's looking at us. What did she say?
Oh, sorry, sir. No one was listening.
Is it garbage night? We left the toilet seat up. What is it, woman? What?
I'm joy. This is sadness. That's anger.
What?
This is disgust. And that's fear.
Ah!
We're Riley's emotions.
Woo-hoo! Yay!
These are Riley's memories. They're mostly happy, you'll notice, not to brag.
I wanted to maybe hold one.
What happened? Sadness?
She did something to the memory.
Is everything okay?
I don't know.
Can't get back, Joy.
I'm trying.
Joy, no,
let's
wait.
Go.
The core memories!
Ah! No.
Can I say that curse word now?
What do we do now?
Nothing's working. Why isn't it working?
We have a major problem.
Oh, I wish Joy was here.
We can fix this. We just have to get back to headquarters.
That's long-term memory. You could get lost in there.
Think positive.
Okay. I'm positive you will get lost in there.
What was that? Was it a bear?
There are no bears in San Francisco.
I saw a really hairy guy. He looked like a bear.
This place is huge. Imagination Land?
No way. Dream Productions?
Rainbow Unicorn.
She's right there.
I loved you in Fairy Dream Adventure Part 7. Okay, bye. I love you. You can't focus on what's going wrong. There's always a way to turn things around. It's broccoli.
Congratulations, San Francisco. You've ruined pizza.
The birthday girl!
Ah!
Brain freeze!
Ah! Hang on! Uh-oh. Riley, here we come!
I love that film. Inside, I don't know whether you guys watched it. I spoke to some clinical psychologists that I work with after watching the film. They tell me that it's not entirely accurate, but it is still a very, very clever illustration of what goes on in your mind. Basically, what it's saying is that there are innate characteristics and ways of thinking and core values inside of us that would control what we say, how we think, and ultimately, how we behave as well. How well we are on the inside, how healthy we are on the inside, can be seen by the evidence of how we function on the outside. If our body is well and healthy on the inside, it can be seen by how we function on the outside. If our soul is well on the inside, it can be seen by how we function on the outside. If our spirit is well on the inside, it can be seen by how we function on the outside. The evidence of how well you are on the inside is shown by what you do on the outside. Paul had something to say about this in Titus. I'll just bring it up and I'll read it to you. To the pure, all things are pure, but to the defiled and unbelieving, nothing is pure. But both their minds and their consciousness are defiled. They profess to know God, but they deny him by their works, by what they do. They are detestable, disobedient, unfit for any good work. If your inside is pure, the things you say and think and do will be pure. They will come out pure. If you're healthy within, everything you say, you think, and do will come from that position of a healthy heart, a healthy inside. If your heart is defiled and unfit, then the things you say, think, and do will also be defiled. It's the same for us. If you think about it, if we're always complaining, if we're cynical, is that the condition of our heart? If we behave ungraciously and have unforgiveness, is that a reflection of the condition of our heart on the inside? If we lack trust and have bitterness to others, is that a reflection of the condition of our heart? If we lash out with anger, is that a reflection the condition of our heart? If we're arrogant in our behavior, is that a reflection of the condition of our heart? On the flip side, if we display love, is that a reflection of the condition of our heart? If we carry joy with us all the time that spills out to other people, demonstrated joy. If we have peace within a storm, You know, I know a few of us are in a storm right now, but I've seen your demonstration of peace. Is that a reflection of the condition of your heart? If we demonstrate patience, if we demonstrate kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, self-control, is that a reflection of what is inside of us, the condition of our heart? You know, the fruit of the Spirit, as we just kind of mentioned them, the fruit of the Spirit and the works of the Spirit are largely to benefit the body of Christ and those around you and I. Largely. It's not for us. It's actually largely to benefit the body of Christ and for those around us. How can it benefit others if it's not demonstrated on the outside? How can it benefit others if it's not demonstrated on the outside? If you're inside, the things that are going on inside, the health of you on the inside, is not demonstrated on the outside. If the fruit of the Spirit of God inside of you, is not demonstrated on the outside, how can it benefit others? Paul was describing an inside-out faith in Titus, an inside-out faith. How you are on the outside is just a reflection of what's going on the inside. Jesus also spoke about this when he was rebuking the Pharisees. He says in Mark 7, verse 21, "For it is from within, out of a person's heart, that evil thoughts come. Sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, greed, malice, deceit, lewdness, envy, slander, arrogance, and folly. All these evils come from inside and defile a person." Jesus was trying to explain to the Pharisees that the condition of their heart, their inside, is what defiles them, not the outside, not the things that they're touching or the rituals that they're doing. He was trying to tell them that their actions showed the condition of their heart. And it's the same for us. Our actions, how we demonstrate, what we say, what we think, what we do on the outside, demonstrate the condition of our heart on the inside. The Christian life that we're called to doesn't work backwards. You can't change your works on the outside and expect that your heart will be changed on the inside. It's not the right way around. That's what the Pharisees and religious leaders did. They thought that if they kept all the rules, they did the right things on the outside, did things by the law, they would be in right standing with God. But it's their heart that defiled them. It's their heart that disqualified them. It's just like thinking that by running a marathon, I'll get fit on the inside. It doesn't work that way. You collapse. You give up halfway. It's the wrong way round. You need to ensure that your heart is healthy and fit by proper diet and exercise and training. Then you tackle that marathon. And then the completion of that marathon is evidence of how fit you are on the inside. God works on us from the inside out. Our words, our thoughts, our actions are just a reflection of that. You know, there's an interesting difference about Jesus and defilement when compared with the high priest like Aaron, high priest like Aaron in Moses' time. You know, when Aaron wanted to enter the Holy of Holies in Moses' time, he had to make sure that he went through all the rituals to make sure he was clean before going into the Holy of Holies, absolutely clean. He had to do all the right things. If he missed a step, or he sinned, or he accidentally touched something that was unclean, he would become defiled and considered unclean as well. So they spent, the high priest of that time spent all their time and effort making sure that they were clean, they were right, they were not defiled, they were pure before they could go in. The great, great high priest, Jesus, was the direct opposite. When he came into contact with the thing that was unclean, the leper, the prostitute, the sinner, he didn't become defiled. In fact, not only did he not become defiled, he made that thing clean as well. He made that thing pure as well. He made that thing whole again. Can you see how powerful our God is? the cleansing power of our Savior Jesus. Not only does he not become defiled, but he makes anything that he comes into contact with pure and clean and whole again. In today's context, if Aaron was here, Aaron, the high priest in Moses' time, if he came into contact with someone with COVID, he would get it. But if Jesus was here and he came into contact with someone with COVID, he would not get it. And not only that, he would make that person well and clean and pure again. You know, Christmas is just right around the corner. The reason we celebrate Christmas is really the ultimate celebration of Jesus coming out from the thing that is pure and whole and clean, coming out of heaven, reaching out into the world that was defiled and unclean, and making it pure again, and making it whole again, and restoring it all back to him. So today, church, as we are in this wellness center, I don't know whether you realize, but the wellness center we're talking about today is not actually a physical building that my dad imagined when he was there that you can walk into and get your health checked. It's actually the place inside you and I. It's a place we find ourselves when we center our lives on Jesus. We center our lives on Jesus. And when we choose to do this, the one who makes all things well will heal and restore and clean and make you pure on the inside. That is the wellness center we're talking about. From that center of wellness inside, the outflowing comes out in all we say and do and we think. That is the wellness center. Dear friend, I pray that you may enjoy good health and that all may go well with you, even as your soul is getting along well. Can I get the worship team up, please? How was your visit to the wellness center? How was your health checkup today, church, family? Was it okay? Are you careful with what you feed your body and your mind? Are you making sure you're getting enough exercise to be physically, mentally, and spiritually fit? You know, God showed me in the weeks preparing for this, in my life, that the evidence of inner wellness for me was not quite there. He showed me numerous occasions where the things that I thought, the things that I said, and the things that I did was a reflection of an insight that was probably a little bit far from the Father's heart. I don't know how you guys did with your health checkup today. But you know God, Jesus, he's calling us today to step in to the wellness center. He's inviting us to center ourselves, our whole person, our body, our soul, our spirit, to center it on him. And then from that place, because he is the great high priest, because he makes all things pure, he makes all things clean, anything that he comes into contact with, he restores. From that place of restoration, from that place of healing, from that place of wellness comes that outflowing in the things that we say, things that we think, and the things that we do. That's the call today, church, to come in to the wellness center, to center our lives on God, everything that we do. And from that place, that inside out faith will come out, that inside out faith.